My role at Hughes is to learn. My job is to learn about industries, the convenience store industries, to learn about its strengths, learn about its weaknesses, learn about the problems that it's having, and to figure out solutions, and to try to find ways to put technology solutions together to kind of solve these problems. I spend a lot of time talking to our customers. I spend even more time talking to people who are not our customers. I'm looking for that big picture view. I do spend a lot of time in conferences like this to try to gather as much information as I possibly can. And I also spend a lot of time in associations where we have technology standards, where we're trying to meet together to actually build solutions, establish standards for the industry. And I don't just focus on the C-store, because I believe that a lot of the problems and a lot of the solutions that we're looking for are not just in the C-store industry. And so I'll study the retail industry, the restaurant industry, banking and finance, and I'll pull from all of these different things. So my purpose today is to try to talk to you a little bit and share with you about some of the things that I've learned from these past couple of years. You know, in all the conferences that I go to, there's just no denying that there's lots of problems and lots of challenges that the industry is facing. And this is just a kind of little snapshot, and I'm sure if we pass the mic around, there would be plenty of others that you could add to this list. The difficulty and the dilemma here is that any one of these by themselves would be overwhelming. And now we're in the midst of a perfect storm where you've got all of these coming together at the same time. And so I think the big takeaway here is it's not business as usual. It's not, hey, the C-store industry has been here for 100 years and it will be here for hundreds of years to come. That's always true. There is a certain resilience about this industry that is undeniable. But we're in a market context that is unusual. This is not normal. Maybe one of these would be normal, but now we got all four of these and then some, all coming together. And it can be quite overwhelming. And so the question then becomes, how do you make sense of all this? And more importantly, how do you create a framework for thinking about these problems and putting together a strategy, a solution for addressing these problems, and how to not only survive, but even thrive and develop a competitive advantage in these kind of scenarios? So that's what I want to talk to you about today. And if there was one thing to take away from this meeting, it would be kind of this little one-page wonder that I have been thinking about. This little picture captures my view of the C-store industry, or this is my interpretation of all the things that have happened. When I look at all the big challenges that are facing the industry, the first question I come through is, then what's the secondary impact? What's the next thing? What is the impact on the industry directly for the C-store? So for example, we think about a global conflict. There's a war going on in Ukraine. How does that affect the C-store industry? Well, it's not only a fight on the battlefield or in the cities in Ukraine. It's also an expectation that a key way that hostile nations attack us is through our businesses. And so there should be a natural understanding, an elevation, an escalation of cybersecurity attacks. We know that the easiest, the quietest, and the safest way for other nations to attack our country is through our businesses. It's an economic attack through our cybersecurity, data breaches and the like, ransomware and the like. And so we want to prepare for that. We want to upgrade and elevate our cybersecurity posture in order to be able to deal with these challenges. Some of the other things that we think about the war in Ukraine is not only the rising fuel costs, but also the rising cost of food and grain. And so when you think about it, it's incredible. We were already dealing with inflation beforehand, and now we've got fuel and food dramatically elevated in costs, 20% over 2021, another 27% even just this year alone. And when food becomes more expensive, what that translates is we got a consumer now that has a much smaller discretionary spend. And so the question then for the C-store industry is, how do we engage with that consumer who's got a lot less money to work with than they did before? You know, for the C-store industry, it's very normal and natural for us to charge a premium for our products. You pay 50% more for a candy bar in a C-store because it's convenient. You're in the moment. In the past 2 years, a big part of the messaging for C-stores was cleanliness. It was safe to kind of buy food and buy products, and are safer to come to a C-store to buy stuff than it would be for a grocer or the like. Well, now that COVID's kind of behind us, or we're getting COVID behind us, and because we have inflation and all these rising fuel costs, maybe it's time now for a new message to come through, that a C-store is a good place for value. That if you're suffering from rising fuel costs, rising food costs, and you have a less of a discretionary spend, you want to come to the C-store for the value-oriented products offerings into as well. And so we want to start thinking through, how do we need to change our ability and our ways of engaging with our customers? We already when we talk about, you know, these other, these next two, the labor shortage and the competition, labor shortage is top of mind, not only for this industry, but for every industry. And you're all competing for the same talent. You know, it's kind of hard to imagine that a few years ago, the biggest top news was that it's going to be a $15 an hour minimum wage. That doesn't really matter anymore. You can pay $20 an hour and you're still not getting the labor that you're looking for. And so now the big problem is how do we get the people in the store so that we can even be open for 24 hours a day and cover all the shifts? And I think one of the big key things to think about is you're not just competing with other C-stores. You're competing with other markets. The restaurant industry, the retail industry, they're all paying the same thing. They're all suffering in the same kind of way. This great resignation has taken millions of people out of the employment pool, and now everybody is fighting for the same kind of workers. And so now it begs the solution of how are you going to more effectively compete? And I think this is a good place to start thinking about, well, there's what we do in the C-stores, but I think this is where, at least from what I've seen, where more of the value comes from looking at other industries. Look at what the retailers are doing. Look at what the restaurants are doing too as well, in addition to what other C-stores are doing. And they are flowing, they are turning to technology. They're turning to technology in such a way as so that they can onboard, evaluate and onboard employees quicker, that they can take a candidate, see them, and by the end of the day, even present an offer to them. They're using mobile solutions are becoming the norm now, where everyone has an app, and if they want to trade shifts with a colleague and the like, they can trade not only with a person in the store, they can trade with another store, pick up other shifts. They can share employees across their stores in many cases. So when we start thinking about the labor shortage and the like, it basically speaks to how do I more effectively compete and draw employees into my business, but also how do I automate and get the paperwork out of my business so that what little labor I do have, I'm going to be able to apply it to engage with my customers and put it where a machine can't compete. So when we start thinking about these things, my encouragement to you is to look not only at what other technologies and what other solutions C-stores are doing, but look at the restaurant industry, look at the retail industry, and watch how they're playing this game out too as well. And start considering some of the solutions that they are adopting to improve their competitive position. This last one, the competition, it's remarkable when you think about what's happening in the C-store industry today. Food is the prime source of profitability for most C-store restaurants today. That puts you in direct competition with QSRs and with grocery. And they, too, are also fighting for that same share of stomach. And the question that you're going to have to ask is, how do you compete with that? How are you going to compete with the QSR, the grocery, and also the dollar store? They are also all competing for that same opportunity too as well. And we're going to talk a little bit about that too as well. So you think about all these big problems, and yes, there are many, many more. You think about the direct consequences on the business. And then you start to kind of generalize the themes of saying, if I had to summarize all of this up, well, it translates into decreasing store sales and increasing operational costs. And if I would say, this is my problem statement. This is what we're dealing with. This is what we want to fix. This is what we want to solve. So one of the things, as we start to think about this, is in addition to understanding the problem, we also need to understand the context. And one of the big challenges with the C-store industry specifically is, like many other industries, the desire not to spend any more than you have to. The desire to refrain from minimizing your technology investments. And so one of the realities here is there is a fixed share of wallet. There's a fixed amount of money that one can spend on these kinds of solutions. So in light of that, you know, if I were to offer one thing to say, hey, where can we actually put my finger on trying to improve this business? How do we turn this boat around? How do we improve our competitive posture? I started looking at the C-store industry about 15 years ago. And 15 years ago, it was the same 30%. And what I'm speaking about is the conversion of your fuel patron into your retail patron. Only about 30% of the people who pump fuel and fill up their tanks are actually going into the retail side of the business. And so, you know, this morning, McGinnis was speaking about how do we get a greater share of a shrinking market? Well, one of the methods that I would suggest, and one of the key areas that I would focus on is the key advantage that the C-store industry has over QSR, over grocery, and over dollar stores is the fuel. It's the fuel of traffic. You have traffic that none of these other competing organizations or industries have. and a very small portion of that traffic, only 30%, is actually going into the C-store. So a prime area for grabbing a greater share in a shrinking market is to get a greater share of your strongest competitive advantage. Convert that traffic from the fuel patient, focus on converting that fuel patient into a retail patient. The second part of the recipe, if you will, is for those who do go in the store and buy a drink, 30% of those guys are going to a QSR within 30 minutes to buy dinner. And so the other piece of this leakage is to say it's not only 30% about the getting them into the store, it's also when they're in the store and buying something from your store, get them to buy your food bill too as well. And this speaks to retail and the like. So as we start to think through kind of these challenges, my encouragement to start to address this is to look at what the restaurant industry is doing, how they are handling food, the technology stacks that they are building. This becomes a very interesting place. Restaurants have suffered dramatically over the last 2 years. Over 110,000 of them have gone out of business. And so you can see how they have fought really hard to survive, and the tactics they are using are quite impressive. So many of them, almost overnight, ran to technology, ran to online ordering, curbside ordering, DoorDashes, and the like. It was the same playbook across the entire industry. And I see the same kind of playbook being played out in the C-store industry. So many C-stores now are trying to expand their food presence with DoorDash, the club level, and even these deep delivery service platforms and these DSPs. So there's a nice synergy there. There's a nice, interesting, and then when you look at what's happening with ghost kitchens and virtual brands, for so many C-stores, what's the other big advantage of the C-store? It's the footprint, the number of stores, your location to your consumer base. Well, that footprint, that point of presence, in conjunction with your ghost kitchens and your virtual brands, could become a very compelling offering. So we think about C-stores in terms of trying to develop their own food offerings. Also think about C-stores just strategically aligning with the partners and the players that are available to you. So I think there's compelling opportunities. Unfortunately, there's so much to talk about and the like, but I do want to actually go and leave you with some of the challenges. As we start to move into these kinds of solutions, very quickly, I think that the number one problem that you're going to face is the integration and being able to put all these solutions together. And so I think in light of that, and this is how I just kind of leave it because of due to the time that we have here, as you start thinking through these challenges and thinking through these issues, my recommendation or some pointers to think about it in these kind of things is to look at your technology stacks and look at kind of how they're formed and how they're shaped. So many times in the C-store industry, we are looking to get the cheapest thing that we can because of the cost. But the cheapest pieces of the puzzles that we put together, in many cases, become quite expensive to maintain, to operate, and in terms of their limitations and their capabilities. And so my encouragement to you is this, when you start to think about how technology may be applied to kind of solve and kind of deal and address some of these challenges and these problems, look at the tech stacks that others have built. Look at the tech stacks that are being commonly deployed. It's not just a matter of what's the cheapest solution and application that you can get your hands on. It's also a matter of what's the most popular, what's the most vetted, what's the most applied and proven systems and technologies and pieces that have been put together already today. You can get some idea by participating in trade associations and organizations, these kinds of conferences, talking to your vendors and your suppliers alike. But the number one question is, what's already been done successfully and what's been out there, and to be able to kind of collaborate too as well. The Lone Ranger in this kind of scenario might be able to come up with their own sweetheart deal with each individual supplier, but when they put all these pieces together, they're on their own with the problems and the challenges and the difficulties they're going to deal with. This is just a taste of some of the things. There's so much more to talk to you about. Unfortunately, we only get 10 minutes to talk, but I would very much like to share with you and engage with you and continue the dialogue and the discussion. So, as I kind of mentioned before, I spend a lot of my time talking to operators like yourselves, trying to understand what are the problems, what are the solutions that you're looking for, what are the things that make sense for this industry, and happy to kind of help in whatever way I can. Okay?